Chaka Pilgrim is a music industry executive who currently serves as the president of Rock Nation Records. Tom Calderone is currently global head of content partnerships for music streaming service Spotify. Formerly, he was the president of MTV Networks and led VH1 as an executive vice president. Tom Calderone. Darnell Hunt, professor of sociology and director of the Ralph J. Bunch Center for African American Studies at UCLA. The Bunch Center released the 2015 to 2014 Hollywood Diversity Report, making sense of the disconnect that sparked change, highlighting the amount of underrepresentation of the industry. Darnell Hunt! Mark Garcia is currently the director of operations for AMC Theaters and has a history with the company since 86. He's also a graduate of the University of San Diego in psychology. Mark Garcia! Jenna Bond is the member service manager of one of the unions. I'm a member of the Writers Guild of America East, where she focuses on guiding and encouraging writers through the business of entertainment and media. Jenna Bond! Staci R. Collins Jackson, a woman with too many names, is the founder and lead of the Collins Jackson Agency, where she represents films including Girl Trip, starring J.D. Pinkett Smith, Queen Latifah, Regina Hall, Tiffany Haddish, Think Like a Man, Think Like a Man 2, Gabrielle Union, Taraji P. Henson, Kevin Hart, Michael Ealy, formerly director of communications at Harpo Studios, and publicist for someone you've heard of, Ms. Oprah Winfrey, Staci R. Collins Jackson. Karen Horne is the SVP of Programming and Talent Development and Inclusion at NBC Universal Home now. She reports to some people and some big time people, and she runs the NBC Writers on the Verge program, the Emerging Director program, NBC Stand Up for Diversity Nationwide. Karen Horne. Jordana Meade is in global marketing, branding, and sales strategy at Starz Entertainment. She previous stints at Cinedigm and serves on the board of directors of Women in Film and Television. Jordana Meade. And last but certainly not least, this Grammy Award nominee, singer, songwriter from Britain. She achieved worldwide recognition when she won the third series of The X Factor and her single, Bleeding Love, from her debut album, spent 7 weeks at number one. I used that song on a lot of my dates. It worked out really well. Lewis recently made her a Broadway debut. And the musical revival of Cats, where she's on stage today. In fact, she has to leave here to go do the matinee. The incomparable, the incredible Miss Leona Lewis. Okay, so you see, we have a very small panel for you right now. And we got to get through this, and we got to get everyone talking. Let's first, since we haven't talked about music really at all in the first panel, let's dive into the music industry real quick. Miss Leona Lewis, could you talk about your journey as a musical artist? And if there's somebody out here who wants to be an artist and think about their role, and how would you go about saying, if someone says, you know what, I want to be a rapper, I want to be a singer, how would I even think about making a living doing that?
Well, first of all, I started I'm from the UK.
Oh, I like her. Isn't her voice really nice? That's so fantastic. Okay, go.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad my song helps you on your dates, by the way.
No, it was very, it really, really it helped a lot. I didn't think I would get to first base. I didn't get to first base, but I got halfway down from home plate.
Oh.
Which means I got to hold somebody's hand.
All right, that's nice.
It was good. It was good.
So,
I like holding hands. What's wrong with that?
That's good. So I started off in the UK. I went to a school called The Brits, which is sponsored by the British recording industry. So I had 3 years of education there, and that's where I got my BTEC in music. I think that for me, it's not just about being a singer, but knowing all about the music industry. So I did music technology. I'm also a musician. I play the piano, the guitar.
So what you're saying is having a knowledge base or education and training in all aspects, not just saying, hey, I'm going to show up and sing. That's
exactly
important.
Just be very well-rounded. I want to know how I can produce my own music, even though I don't call myself a producer, and there are people that are amazing at doing that. I want to know all about every single craft that goes into what I do and goes into supporting what I do. So that is the production, and that is all of the musicians, the drummer, the percussionist, the guitarist. I think it's just about being very well-rounded.
And Tom, you're an executive, right?
Okay.
In the entertainment business. What does it mean when someone says you're an executive in the entertainment? Like, how do you become an executive, and how and what? What's your journey, and what does that mean?
You know, it really started for me in college, you know, working at the college radio station, and realizing that that's what I wanted to do. I was also lucky enough that in my high school, we had a broadcast radio station as well. So getting into that was really important to me. And just somehow, I was wired to think that I had no plan B. Like, this had to work for me. So, you know, paying your dues is a big part of it. I did overnights at AM radio stations running public affairs shows and music that I personally didn't like. And then eventually became a marketing director and just kind of worked my way up. And then I was lucky enough one day to get a call from MTV, from Judy McGrath, and said, we've heard some good things about you. Like to
So what's the difference? And this is a question I get asked a lot. If you're an executive in like the music industry or in the entertainment business, what's the difference of being an executive in entertainment than being an executive, for instance, for Kraft Foods or some other just company that doesn't do entertainment?
From my experience, being an executive in the entertainment business is treating all your employees like they are talent. They're creative people. They are people that are wired a different way, and with that bedside manner to kind of navigate and help them through a difficult challenge or a piece of production or a piece of audio that you need to help them to win with, it's kind of nurturing that spirit, because I think all of us that get into this industry have a lot of insecurities and somewhat a little bit shy or what have you, and getting them the opportunity to feel like they can win in this space is really important. It just doesn't happen like that. There are lightning rod moments, there's those lightning in a bottle where a hit happens, whether it's a music hit or a TV hit, but in the end, it all has to be nurtured, so you just have to find that diamond in the rough and just, you know, mentor them and get them going through the creative process.
Chaka, could difficult. You talk about your journey and talk about what led to your success and talk about how you started entertainment and what was the path that you traveled?
I have a unique experience in the fact that I wasn't interested in the music business. I had a friend, Jay-Z, who was a rapper at the time.
I never heard of him.
At the time, I didn't hear of him either. But I knew he had a dream, and he had a group of friends that had a dream, and I kind of just ended up helping. And I think...
How did you help?
Whatever was necessary. Move boxes, put up posters, call radio stations.
Okay, so this is an interesting question, you guys. Now, I want to ask this question. So there are a lot of people out there that say, I'm a rapper, I'm trying to make rhymes, I'm trying to do this. What made you decide to work with Jay as opposed to Lene, the guy who never made it?
I have worked with some people who've never made it as well. I think for me, it was about a genuine connection with the friendship and helping. And I think it just manifested into success. And I think it's why there's such a strong company. I think it's why there's a few people who are still present. It's because you're not above the task and you don't put yourself before the artist or the art. So I'm an invisible part of this great thing, and I'm happy to be an invisible part and to fill in wherever the holes are. I think Tom just mentioned the cultivation and creating the proper environment for somebody to create, because I think it's so important for people to get the music and to get the message. And when you put yourself in front of that, you're blocking other people's inspiration. So I think, you know, I just in looking at my journey, not just in front of the screen, but behind the screen, you see people disappear all the time because they begin to think it's about them. And it's really not about you. It's about the art and the process.
That's amazing. So Professor Hunt, I love saying Professor Hunt. You know, he's one of our leading professors in this country. Can you talk about you analyze and look at studies. You know more about diversity in the entertainment business and hiring practices. What are some of the things you can share as you look at the entertainment business as a whole, as a professor, and why is it important for you to actually dedicate your life to studying the entertainment business and pointing out what's going on in it?
Well, great questions. I think the most important issue for me is that the stories that the entertainment industry tells are the stories that give us a sense of who we are and who we aren't. For example, people who come to this country who have never had experience with certain groups, they think they know about those groups based on the stories they saw circulating in Hollywood movies and TV shows. In other words, the industry has an impact on shaping the way we see other people and the way we think about ourselves. Sometimes we internalize those images and we get sort of misconceptions about ourselves. So as a sociologist, I want to know what impact this industry is having on society. And I think that we're at a really important point in history where our stories are becoming more and more important because we're on the verge of becoming the majority, believe it or not. At the same time, we have an industry that doesn't really look like our society. So what we're trying to do in our reports that we release every year is to document how much progress we're actually making, where the bottlenecks are, where the opportunities for change are, and to really help the industry do a better job, and to help people like yourselves figure out where the opportunities are so that you can become a part of the narratives we're going to tell in the future.
What's your journey? See, there may be someone out here who actually wants to be a college professor. How do you become a college professor? How do you even do that?
Well, becoming a college professor is a labor of love. You become basically an expert in a particular area. Of course, you do well in school. You apply yourself. It's important, like in the entertainment industry, to have a mentor, someone who can kind of hold your hand and kind of guide you, and you can emulate what they've done, and that's how you become successful. You have to go to graduate school. You have to do something called a dissertation, where you write the study that eventually becomes a book that's like the definitive word on a particular topic. In my case, I did a dissertation on media and race and how politics kind of flow from that. And everything I've done since then, including looking at the Hollywood industry, has been based on that basic fountain of knowledge about race, media, politics.
So, thank you for that. So, Karen Horne, you work for a huge, one of the biggest entertainment companies in the world, and you've also been involved in doing a lot of programs and projects that develop and cultivate talent and diversity. Number one, why, and what are the things that you've noticed of the folks that have come out of your programs that have experienced success versus folks that have come out of your programs that maybe hit some roadblocks and ultimately didn't make it in the business?
Hi, Hill. How are you?
Good.
Hi, everyone. So yeah, I work for Comcast NBC Universal, which is one of the biggest companies. They make my job easy, quite honestly.
Can you break down that when you say Comcast NBC Universal? What does that represent? How big is that, and what are we talking about in terms of entertainment and media?
So Comcast is the cable company that's not available in Manhattan or in Los Angeles, where I live. But it is a cable company that acquired NBC Universal. NBC Universal is NBC Television, Universal Features,
Universal Studios,
our theme parks.
What are some of Universal movies that are huge movies?
Well, we have this wonderful producer named Will Packer that does all the ride-along movies, the Fast Furious movies that are produced by Vin Diesel and those groups. 50 Shades of Grey, if you're into that kind of stuff, was also produced by the sequel's coming out. There's a big dearth. There's a huge amount of Universal feature films. Girl Trip is coming out. Yeah, that's coming out. So, Staci's Will's publicist, so she can tell better. But Will Packer is a producer that we have an overall deal with, both on our feature side and on our television side as well. So it's a big. I work more on the television side of things, and you were asking about the programs, the success of some people who do come out, and the success of some people who don't. I would say that the success is the same. It depends on the people who come out of the program. So the programs, what they do is they open up doors for you. They give you exposure. You have to be very talented in order to get into anything. It's very competitive. Our writing program is probably over 2,000 submissions every year for 8 slots.
How do you find out about the programs that are, I'm not just your
well,
program.
Well, funny, you should ask.
Because
I actually have some of these cards. I don't have enough, but we will leave them. The website is NBCUNITips.com. But if you go if you Google writing programs or you go to the WGA's website, they'll list every single writing program there, including competitions and everything like that. We have an emerging directing program that has absolutely changed the lives of people who've gone through that program because we put our money behind what we do in terms of our talent development. There are programs for, if you're a comedian, our nationwide search for stand-up comedians. We just did a scene showcase here in Los Angeles New York. Where am I? New York.
You're in New York. You're in New York, yeah. In fact, you're in Brooklyn.
Brooklyn.
Where I live.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
Well, you just gonna tell people your address? What's up?
Well, here's the deal. Jay-Z is like the king of Brooklyn. I'm not the prince. I'm like the if you play chess, I'm like the rook of Brooklyn. I live in Brooklyn, which I love.
Here's what I'm gonna say. When I started in this industry, I was like most of you, I assume, out there. I'm from New Jersey. I didn't know anyone in this industry. My generation is perhaps the first generation that can practice nepotism, and I full well plan to do that for my children. If they want to be in this, we are probably the first one to do that. So I have a single mom household. I knew no one. I went to school in New Jersey. I got a job at ABC in New York as a receptionist, and I was the one person. The one person who was there early, the one person who was there late. I was the one that they counted on. I got promoted and was eventually moved to Los Angeles to work in ABC Entertainment. So you can do this if you want to do this. Now there are programs to help you because we recognize that we need to broadcast. Our shows need to come from people who look like those who we broadcast. They need to star people who look like those who we broadcast to. That, you know, we recognize the importance of that, and that makes us better broadcasters. Diversity is good for storytelling.
So Karen, you mentioned the WGA, and we have Jenna here. Jenna, let's talk about the Writers Guild and talk about what a union like that represents and also programs that may be available, because there were a lot of writers out here and creators. How can they get access to the WGA, and what is the WGA in the first place?
So the WGA is actually a union of everyone who writes all that seen and heard on entertainment and media. So if you're watching The Daily Show or a late night show, if you're reading what was part of Gawker Media, now part of Univision, if you're watching a web series, if you're watching House of Cards, those people are represented by our union. And we set the standard that you get when you see a work on television, you see the written by credit. That wasn't done when Hollywood was created. It was a studio production. We make sure that writers have a minimum on what they can get paid. We make sure that you can have weekends off, that you have, if you start a family, that you can have leave. And so that side of writing.
What programs do you have that they may be able to access?
And in terms of programs, we just launched last Thursday, if you're over 18 years old and you obviously live in New York, the Made in New York Writers Room, where we're gonna pair 12 writers or writing teams with showrunners. So Bo Williman, who's with House of Cards, Lee Daniels with Empire, to bring more productions to New York that are committed to making sure those productions look like New York. So I don't know if you've ever watched a show and the extras are all not diverse and it's based in Midtown. It disturbs me. So when I see shows like Jessica Jones and outside of the lead characters that they take care to make sure the extras look like they're in New York, that's a thing that not only people of color in our union, but all, even though we're a mainly white male organization, those white males want to make sure that they shift the culture to make sure that it's a reflective of what America, what New York City, what Brooklyn, what Harlem looks like.
Mark Garcia, something we haven't talked about at all is this whole distribution side of entertainment. You are at AMC Theaters. Could you tell us what a job, you know, what kind of jobs are there on the distribution side, meaning the side of the business where after the whole thing is done and made, how do we actually get it to the eyeballs? What are the jobs in your area, and what does it mean to you to work for AMC?
Well, it's there's a lot of jobs in the area, actually, and AMC Theaters is really the exhibition side. We work closely with distribution to make sure that everything we've talked about as far as making things, making movies, gets out and gets seen by everybody else. So that's really a big part of our job. But really, AMC Theaters offers a wide variety of career options, whether it be operating the actual theaters, or it's programming the theaters on the film side. Human resources.
So if I started working in an actual theater, is there a path for me to move up? Like, literally, I start serving popcorn. Could I move up within that theater and actually run the theater? What are my options there?
That's a great question, because that's what I did.
That what you did?
Yeah, I started 3 days before my high school graduation. I started with AMC, and here I am. So right now I work at our theater support center. I oversee the theaters in New York, Connecticut, and Massachusetts, and get to work with all the general managers and all of their teams at 34 locations to help them do all the things that we want to do as far as diversity and creating theater teams that reflect the communities that we serve. But at the same time, they're learning how to run a business. They're learning how to recruit talent. They're learning how to create and execute budgets. They're learning how to manage a food business and a film business and to interact with guests. So it's really a really wide range of owning your own business without a huge capital investment on their side.
Thank you for that. Who out here watches the show Power? Power. I love Power. Omari Hardwick's a good buddy of mine. Jordana Meade, she's the global marketing and branding and sales strategy at Starz, which is the home of Power. Could you talk about what you do and how having a show like Power is important, and what does that represent?
Hi, good morning, everyone. First, I want to say you just being here and attending something like this and knowing something like this exists in the city and taking time out of your day, however, talking to your teachers or your family to come is like an incredible step. So you're strides ahead of anyone and everyone who dreams or thinks they want to have some sort of career in entertainment. You may not know how or what. I can't sing, or I don't know how to do math, or whatever. I'm not good at this. Just being here and learning what everyone has done to somehow be associated with this industry is incredible. Keep doing that. Keep finding these things to attend and meeting these people and reaching out to us and digging deeper and then digging deeper into yourself to see what interests you, and then keep hitting that punching bag. So, to answer Hill's question, what I do is actually really cool. I think that most folks don't realize that there is a job where I specifically focus on the digital platform. So you guys have ever heard of iTunes, right? Yeah, Netflix, Hulu, that sort of thing. Digital Xbox, PlayStation. Think of the last movie that you watched. How did you watch it? Did the first time you saw it, did you see it in theaters? Netflix? Did you buy it or rent it on iTunes? No, you guys are just straight. Did you BitTorrent it or whatever? No, illegal. Someone on this panel, just kidding, but it's true, it's illegal. So that's what I deal with. I'm specifically working with our content, things like Power, Survivor's Remorse, and then I even work with movie studios, so like the Weinstein Company. You guys watch Django Unchained, The Hateful Eight.
So how did you, just break down for us, what was your journey? Like, how did you get from beginning, and where was that beginning to getting to this seat right now?
So my beginning was understanding what my passion was, and my passion was movies. I didn't know, I just loved watching movies. I loved geeking out and talking about the actors and the directors and that sort of thing. So I realized that's what I was into. And then I thought, well, I want to be a filmmaker. So I connected with the film department at my college or and with my high school and just started moving boxes, working as a PA, basically moving stuff around, and worked my way up to producing really
bad
short films.
What do you say to somebody
film.
Who says, oh, you just took a job moving boxes? I mean, what kind of job is that? Why? Like, a lot of times people don't realize you have to start really, really at the bottom. How do you reconcile that with your ego or what you aspire to be?
For sure. I think that it starts with knowing where you want to go and knowing what your passion is. So if you're moving boxes for Kinko's, that sucks. But if you're moving boxes because you like the film and you're on a film set, that's kind of a little better. And then you see how the director works and you're like, I want to do that. But first, he has someone, you know, that sort of thing. So that makes moving boxes a little bit better. And then after that, it's just keeping your vision and adjusting and tweaking, but always knowing what that passion and vision is to keep you driving to work your way up.
Staci R. Collins Jackson, you work as PR, marketing, et cetera, right? What does that mean to people out there? What is that? Because I hear people talk about that all the time. What is it, and what was your journey to getting to where you
are? There. So the short answer would be, when you hear people say, have your people call my people, when I was younger, I was like, I want to be the people. So I am the person that is chasing whatever it is that has your attention. So the internet has your attention. That's where I want my client to be. That's where I want their films to be. So PR for me was something that I always knew that I wanted to do. I started out, and I just felt like for me, I wanted to start where I wanted to end up. So I didn't want to do a job in another department and just hope I get there. I made a decision in college that when I leave college, I am going to work at Ebony Magazine. That is what I'm going to do. I'm going to figure it out. Knew nobody, had nothing but determination. Got a job at Ebony Magazine, moved up to vice president of the company, and then left the company to start my own firm. Then got a call from Harpo Studios and Oprah Winfrey's team. I closed up my company and worked for Harpo Studios for 2 years before it closed, and traveled with Oprah and was a part of helping her launch OWN. And then when Harpo closed, went back to my company, which is I represent the people that you don't see, so that people like you can look at clients of mine like Will Packer, who's a producer, where that's not somebody that would be in front of the camera, but he's behind the camera making most of the decisions that have people on television that look like us. So that's always been something that I'm passionate about, are the images of people of color. So that's why I wanted to be at Ebony Magazine. That's why I wanted to work for Oprah Winfrey. That's why I wanted to work in film, because we are huge, huge consumers of entertainment as people of color. And the images that we put out there and what you radiate is what you attract. So I wanted to be a part of making sure that those images were projected properly. So I'm hands-on from the beginning. So on a movie set, literally from soups to nuts. So I'm a part of the process early on when they're choosing the talent to being on set every single day, making sure that we have video, we have photos, and all the different things that you see when a movie comes out. The publicist that's on that movie is responsible for getting all of that. So every single day, the focus is on getting in front of wherever your attention is.
Thank you. Leona, when you think about your journey and how you started, what would you say, if you're going to share with us, you know, what would you say the most important one or two things would be as far as your trajectory and success, and what's something you could share with us?
I think for me, it's just knowing that I have something unique to give that no one else has, and everyone else has something unique to give that I don't have. So it's just staying true to your uniqueness.
How do you do that? How does one stay true?
Well, for me, I have a really great support network. I've got a really great team around me, really great management team that support me that I've been working with for about 10 years. And something interesting as well, my manager now, she started off as an assistant, and I had a really great relationship with her 10 years ago, and now she's my manager. So it's really great kind of seeing other women kind of rise up with you. So it was great to support her and see her journey, and she always believed in me from day one. So having people that believe in you and keeping the right people around you and just keeping a good frame of mind as well. You know, there's ups and downs. I've been through highs, I've been through lows.
How do you deal with the highs and the lows? Like with rejection or disappointment?
I've had a lot of rejection. Before I signed my major deal, I'd signed to a few independent labels. I also, weirdly enough, the one label that rejected me, like I think it was about 12 years ago, they signed me like 3 years ago. So things always come back around. I think it's about timing as well. And like I said, I've had a lot of doors shut in my face, but like where one door shuts, I think another opens. And it's just about staying very, very grateful. Just kind of really pursuing what you're passionate about. And if you have that genuine passion, no matter what happens, you're always going to have the drive to keep going and
so
keep
passion,
pushing through.
Gratitude, those are great things. Chaka, could you talk real quick about being a woman in the music industry? There's a lot of talk about as women in the industry that, you know, are there challenges and issues that are presented with being in the music industry? Are there things that we should think about? What are the challenges that you've had to overcome, and what are some things you've had to deal with yet obviously rise to the top?
I just think that as a woman, you always have challenges because you're amongst predominantly men. And when you're passionate about something, that can be misconstrued coming from a woman. Although I have plenty of men who throw tantrums around me on a daily basis. However, it's different for a woman. You have to kind of maintain your composure and step outside, create a network of people that you can vent to. So
you think there's a double standard?
169%.
So break that down. What does a double standard look like?
A double standard is you have to kind of subscribe to, if you want to. I mean, I don't care. I'm happy with being called whatever comes with me being authentic and fighting for what I want. But just know that for a man being very forceful in the room, it's expected. And for a woman, you can be called the B word. You can be called emotional. You can be called, it's never passionate because passionate is positive. I rephrase it to passionate. But, you know, at the end of the day, you remember that you have a goal. And you fight, you know, and a part of fighting is knowing that there are consequences to that fight or there's a connotation to it, but you want the W, so it's really about the win at the end. And I think taking control and realizing that sometimes no one understands why you were fighting until they see the results of your fight. So if you stop in the middle, you know, it was a fruitless exercise.
So there's a couple themes coming up, you guys. I think you're starting to see. One is being passionate, two is being forceful in terms of your own vision and staying true to yourself. There's another theme about being grateful and proud and basically treating people equally. Who has some questions for our panel? Anybody? Anybody? Yes. Yes, sir.
How you doing? The thing I heard a lot about passion, you know, and people being talented in what they do, but can a couple of you speak about the character that you need to have to stand in this industry? Because without character, I know that you can't stand. You can be placed anywhere, but without the proper character, I think some of us need to hear what kind of character needs to be there.
Okay, so character, how does that play in? Go.
I want to speak to that on a higher sense. I think that you live in a wonderful time where you can be self-appointed. So if you're sitting in the audience and you're like, I'm a director, I'm a writer, I'm a studio executive, there are action steps you can take right now, and it's easier to have character when you have focus. So you could turn on the podcast and listen to Industry Standard and hear the biographies of people who do the right things, and you can just focus on the work. And when you're focused there, you can make better decisions. But if you're worried about how you feel and how you look, it's a lot harder to navigate this industry. When you're an expert, you kind of excel faster.
I'm going to just say something also. This is the real thing. You can be really good at your job, but be a bad person and you will not last at that job. You can do your job fairly good and be a great person, and you'll last at that job a lot longer. We work long hours in this industry, and no one likes to work around people who are too good to pick up boxes, who are too good to do things, or who think that they are above it all, because we're not. No one is above it all. I'm the head of my department, but I will go and get coffee for my assistant as much as I ask him to get coffee for, and I don't, you know, for me, you know, there's no ego. I mean, there's a lot of egos in this business, really, but you have got to get below that. You cannot let that do that. And Hill, I just wanted to say something that Leona pulled out about passion. Passion doesn't only work in the music industry, or your uniqueness. If you guys, I know you asked how many people are writers, and there were a few hands that went up. Even if you're unique, you have a writer, you have a uniqueness about you. You have your own story to tell. As a director, you have your own point of view and your own stories to tell. And those things will help sell you, brand you, in order to give you success. So find your voices. Find who you are in your brand, and that will help you along the way.
We have time for a few more questions.
Can I add one thing to that?
Yeah, yeah, please.
Well, I kind of want to flip the script, too, on this. And it may sound disingenuous, especially when you're going to an entry-level position. But character works both ways. When you're sitting in that office being interviewed, is that the person you want to work for? Mm. Is that the person that's really going to nurture whatever that X factor is that he or she sees in you? That is so important, because without good leadership and without someone with a vision, you're just going to get lost, especially in the early stages of your career. So make sure you also find that person across the desk or what have you that gets you, that can figure out what your game plan is going to be. And if they don't ask you what you want to do in the next couple of years within the company or how they can help you grow, it may not be worth it, because you at least want to find someone that gets you. And it's really important.
My question is for Jenna.
Question for Jenna.
How do you go about selling a script to a studio or a film company?
How do you go about selling a script to a studio or film company?
So there are many routes for that to happen. Usually you're pitching, and so you're working either with your agent.
What does that mean, pitching?
So basically you have like a minute to give a log line. So if we're talking about Billions, which is one of my favorite shows, we're talking about Power, one of my favorite shows. It's about a man trying to escape his past to change his future.
So you're saying the creator of Power may have gone into a meeting and said that right off the top. Said, this is my idea. It's a show called Power, and it's bam.
Yeah,
that's a pitch.
So, or he's like, it's a drug dealer who wants to be the most powerful man in New York. And so the guy's like, oh, I want to know more about it. And then he's like, send me a treatment. And nowadays, a lot of people have to do their own pilot.
But how do you get in the door in the first place? How do I get into that meeting? I don't know how to do that.
Well, hopefully you have a great agent.
How do you get an agent?
Writing programs.
You do the program.
Let's be
what
real.
Else?
Let's be real. You're not going to sell your script to a network or a studio if you're not someone, because a good idea doesn't make a good TV show. A good showrunner makes a good TV show.
What's a showrunner?
A person who is the CEO of that show. So that's the person who's in charge of all the actors down to.
But how do I become that?
Your way up. It's a marathon.
Where do I start?
As a staff writer.
What's a staff writer?
A person who's the lowest level on the show. The lowest level on the show is
a staff
writer.
How do I become a staff writer?
You write a really good script and submit it to programs.
A script about what?
So you take a show you've loved to watch and you write an episode that you would write.
What is that called?
A spec script.
A spec script. A spec script is what? It's a script
that is written on speculation.
What is writing on speculation?
No one has asked you to write this script. You're writing it because you want to show people your ability
as a writer.
So
let me break it down. You're saying if I want to get a job as a staff writer, which is the entry-level position to becoming a showrunner, I have to write a script based on a show like Power or some other show that already exists.
But don't ever send your script to Power because they don't want to see it.
Send another show to the show that you want to work for, but also
or write a pilot.
Try personally to write someone. A showrunner does this. Someone told me they write a script each week. So if you can do that, by the time you start submitting, writing is a practice.
Write a script?
You can actually. I love the Blacklist. They have these free online challenges, so you can download an existing pilot and mimic it. Learn the structure. Learn the pacing. Learn the characters. And everything is repetition until you master it. And when you get to mastery, then you can innovate.
Leona, how do I learn to write a song? If I want to write songs, there's people who write songs and make great livings writing songs.
Yeah,
how do I do that?
There's like methodical ways, but I don't believe in that. I feel like it should come from the heart. It comes, when I write, from personal experience. And also co-creation. I love co-writing with other musicians and other writers. I think that's
when I do
my best
work. So how do you decide who you're
going
to collaborate with?
Oh, well, I have to get along with them as a person. And when you're writing songs, it's like you're digging up like your deepest kind of secrets. So it's very personal. I like to have very personal relationships with the people that I co-write with.
So, who else has a question? We got time for like one more. Okay, he hasn't asked one. Okay.
How you guys doing? My name is Khalil Rowe. I'm a student at NYU, and I have a lot of passions, actually. I go to school for recorded music, but I'm also into film. I'm interested in the way music relates to imagery. So I just wanted to ask you guys, what is a good way to balance your passions?
So he's good at a lot of things. He loves a lot of elements. How can, you know, does he have to focus on one thing first, or should he try to do all the things, or how should he approach this, Tom?
I've always told the students where I've gone to school is, you know, find out what you suck at first and then kind of back in from there. So try everything, because it's the time to make mistakes. You know, it's amazing sometimes you go to a college and go, who belongs to the TV studio or the film studio, and no one raises their hand, and they're broadcasting students. Like, this is the time to make your mistakes. This is the time to find out what you really love and what you're passionate about. But also what I would say now, based on the way the world is right now, you can do a lot of different things, and it's okay. You know, don't be afraid of that. Don't bottleneck yourself into one thing, but just try some things. Even if it makes you feel uncomfortable, being uncomfortable is a good thing. Being out of your element is a good thing, because you'll learn from it.
There's a job, there's music supervisor who connects with films and chooses the music that fits the scene. And we know that sometimes the music is what catapults a movie into the stratosphere. So find out who's the best music supervisors, read their biography, see if they live in your city, connect with them, see if you can have a conversation with them, their assistants, that sort of thing, and chart their path and find out how they became what they became, and if that's of interest to you.
I also want to say, don't wait for anyone to give you permission to do what you love. There are so many avenues out here now that you can put your material online, you can put your songs, no one's going to steal it. Don't wait for someone to give you permission to do what you love. There are agents whose jobs are just to scour the internet to find the next stars that are sitting in these seats right here. Do not wait for permission. Do your stuff. Let us find you. We will, if there's enough heat behind it.
I just got to ask a question. Is having become who you are, luminaries in the entertainment business, is there something that you wish you would have done, or this took you away from? Or is it just, this is, you love it, and there was never any, oh, I wanted to do this, but I ended up doing this. What was the journey?
I wanted to do a lot of different things first. I worked for ABC Sports. I thought I was going to be a broadcast journalist. I thought I was going to do a lot of things. What I did was go where the road took me, and I knew that I didn't know what I didn't know. And there are a lot of things going to the left where you thought you were going to go to the right. There are a lot of things there that are the right things for you, and I think every step of my journey helped me to be better at where I am today. And I think that you have to be open. Like you were saying earlier, there are a lot of mistakes that you're going to make along the way, but learn from them and take them to help you be better at where you end up being.
You guys, give it up for this amazing panel. But check it out. I have a truly special guest that I'm going to bring to the stage. Super duper special. This person I'm about to bring up here is one of the fastest rising stars in the United States of America. He's on the number one show in the world right now. He's got best-selling album right now. He and Leona Lewis have talked about doing a duet together right now. Please welcome superstar, friend of mine, Mr. Jussie Smollett. He's even got security. Look at him. He's got, you know you're famous when you got two big people that walk with you. You know it. This man is a hero of mine. He maintains his integrity.
What's up, everybody?
Keeps who he is. Jussie, talk to us for a second, man. How you doing? So listen, we've been here talking about careers in entertainment and achieving our goals, achieving our dreams. This panelist has really talked about it great. Could you talk very briefly about your journey, obstacles, how you started and where you are now, and how you view yourself in this business?
Well, first of all, I'm so happy to be here. How y'all doing? Thank you to Jada and everybody for inviting me. I'm so happy to be here. So I started at like 4 years old. I started at 4 years old, child model here in New York, baby diapers and all that stuff. And then I went on to do a couple of movies. I was in the Mighty Ducks when I was 8 years old and things like
that. Mighty Ducks!
And then quack, quack. And then I had my own TV. We moved to LA. And we had our own TV show, my siblings and I, on ABC for like a year. Y'all are probably all way too young to even remember that because y'all were probably not born in 94 or 95. And then I quit the business, honestly. I wasn't really sure. I knew that I wanted to be in the business, but I wasn't sure how exactly I was going to navigate my way through all of the obstacles that I was going through personally or whatever, you know? And then I worked what society considers to be regular, real jobs. The thing for me is that as an artist and as a man, as a human being, I always wanted to hold down a job. I always made sure it didn't matter what I had to do. I always supported myself because, and I struggled, don't get me wrong, but I worked every job. I was a clown at children's parties making $40 for an hour of performing for these little snotty-nosed children. I worked retail. I worked at the H&M in Times Square for literally 2.5 hours. I folded clothes, and then y'all come up in there and mess it up. So I was like, I can't do this. I was a bartender at the Lion King on Broadway. Got fired from there because I poured too much alcohol for the people. It was a mess, but I always kept a job. And the thing is that during that time, I was really honing my craft of acting and music and songwriting and as a musician. My mother was always like, nobody's gonna be able to do anything for you better than you can do for yourself. So I got back into the business in like my mid-20s, because I'm 33 now. And then came a little show named Empire.
Yeah, yeah!
By the way, it's Empire Wednesday, in case y'all don't know.
Yeah!
It was the first time that I wanted this the second that I read the script. I wanted it so bad. And I felt like all the different times going up for things and not getting it, being disappointed, what I realized is that I had never felt so strong about something before. And I knew
in my heart. How did you persevere through the rejection?
I had no choice. You know what I'm saying? It's like either we sink or swim, and I'm not a sinker. I'm a swimmer.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you know, we go through things. We go through things in life. We go through things. When I told this story yesterday, I was in a situation where I was so broke, I'd have like $17 in my account. I got to get $3 so I could deposit it into my account so I could take a 20 out. You know what I'm saying? Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. You know? So it was a thing of, I had to keep working because I knew that while everybody was like, yo, let's go kick it, let's go party, let's go do this, and I would be like, nah, I can't, I'm in the studio. I know that a lot of the people were thinking to themselves, why? Nobody's listening to your music. Nobody's listening to you sing. But what they don't realize is that I was going to college for myself. You know what I'm saying? I was trying my best to educate myself as best as possible, and I had such an incredible village in my mother. You know what I'm saying? And it wasn't always easy. The day that I got the script of Empire, I literally DM'd Lee Daniels. And I said, I sing, I act, I'm a songwriter, I'm a musician, I dance, like I'm Jamal Lyon. And all I was trying to do really was just set myself aside so that maybe if he saw my tape, maybe if he saw it, he would remember that I was the dude that was gutsy enough to do it. And I promise you, the day that I met him, he told me, he said, "You DM'd me." And I said, "Yes, sir, I did." And he said, "You're a smart little kitten." So it's just about being a go-getter and just going after it. And I had no choice because I knew that I had a dream. I knew that I had a dream, and I knew that it was bigger than a repossessed car. You know what I'm saying? It was bigger than, you know, block numbers calling my phone and me not being able to answer because I knew it was a bill collector. You know what I'm saying? But I persevered, and there was no option to quit. I heard, and I swear I live my life by this, and I heard Will Smith say this. He said, "There's no plan B. There's only a plan A." I never wanted to have a plan B because I knew exactly what I wanted to do, always since I was a little kid. I just didn't know exactly how I was going to navigate it, and I didn't expect that it would suddenly, there would be this something special. And the reason why I got Empire is because, y'all, it was mine. Anything that you lose it because it ain't yours to keep. You know what I'm saying? But this right here, I knew in my heart of hearts that this was mine. I knew that I had a chance to really make an impact in my life, but also in other lives, because I knew that just by reading that script, I knew how much Jamal changed me and helped me instantly. So I knew that I was going to also have a platform. But with that platform, I also made sure that I kept my feet in my community. I made sure that I raised up my community, I raised up myself. Even in those moments, I keep on saying, you don't need a hit show. You don't need a movie or a bunch of followers on Instagram. You can make a change in your community and around the world just by doing what you're supposed to be doing. And I swear, like, we have this idea that celebrity or success is measured in wealth. But wealth is measured in what you give to other people. And if you're not giving anything to other people and you got a million people listening to you, you should say something worth hearing. You really, really should. And you should hold yourself and other people accountable to be responsible for what are the messages that they're giving out. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, yes. So he doesn't know that I'm going to do this. And because as we close out, we're going to go behind these curtains here. And there's a whole expo of opportunity to network all these different stations of people in the business. It's going to be your chance to talk. But before we do that, I need to hear you just sing a little bit. And it doesn't have to be long. It doesn't even have to be the song that you're going to sing tonight because it's Empire Wednesdays. It could be something from your album. And maybe Leona Lewis will back you up a little bit. I don't know. Anybody else out here that has a little talent can actually back him up a little bit.
You're so beautiful. Give the world a show. Go up, down, up, down, up, down. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Shake it fast. That's all you get.
Jesse Smudge, y'all. Give it up. Stand on your feet. Give it up for this amazing panel. Thank we you love so you much. Guys. We want you to be great. We want you to do great things. Hold on. Oh, we need you. Oh, social media. I need you to hashtag what? Oh, okay. At my CIE story. Check that out. At my CIE story. Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. But beyond that, hashtag CIENYC. Say that with me. CIENYC. One more time. CIENYC. In fact, Jesse, help me with this. We're going to close out. We're going to go over there. But I want you guys to say this with me. I love using affirmations, y'all, because affirmations can keep you going when obstacles come up. So I'm gonna give one of the affirmations I literally use on a daily basis. Jesse's going to say it with you. Panel's going to say it with you. Get your microphones. Right. Say, I will not.
I will not.
No, I need some more vocal energy. I will not.
I will not.
Allow fear.
To stop me.
From making the choices. That I already know I should make. Instead, I will live.
With creativity.
With courage.
With character.
And in so doing,
Give all others.
Permission. To do the same. I will.
Win in my life.
God bless you guys. Thank you so much.